Clone Robotics has just revealed the robot that looks, moves, and simply feels like us. They call it Protoclone. Its body is powered by artificial muscles, bones, blood, and even a beating heart.
Our vision for a musculoskeletal clone comes from a deep desire to make.
So we flew all the way to Wrocław, Poland, to meet the creators of Protoclone and be among the first ones to see it in action. Subscribe if you're curious, and let's get into it. It all started with a muscle. Years ago, Lukasz, now the CTO of Clone Robotics, was experimenting with synthetic muscles. And he stumbled across an unconventional design. No motors, no wires, just rubber tubes. It looked simple, but it turned out to be one of the most radical ideas in robotics. The McKibben muscle. Joseph McKibben, the man behind it, was a physicist who once worked on the Manhattan Project. But his most important invention had nothing to do with atomic bomb. It came from a personal tragedy. His daughter has lost the use of her hands. And McKibben devoted himself to build an artificial muscle so she could use her hands again. Over time, McKibben came up with something new, the pneumatic muscle.
So you have an inner rubber tube, and when it's pressurized with fluid, like a balloon, it expands radially. And when surrounded with an inextensible textile braided sleeve, you're able to constrain that radial expansion of the balloon to produce a linear contraction with a pulling force in a single axis. You get to mimic a lot of the properties of human skeletal muscle this way.
So, with a tube and some air, McKibben managed to replicate some of the nature's most complex mechanisms. This was life-changing for his daughter, and she was now able to eat and even write. This invention became known as a McKibben muscle. Lukasz was fascinated. These muscles were cheap, light, and easy to make. But soon he hit the hard truth. These muscles were weak. You know, like a balloon filled with air. And maybe the story would have ended there. If not for someone else. That's when Danush, Clone Robotics' CEO, stepped in to turn it into a working humanoid. Together, they started to search for a way to make artificial muscles truly powerful. The clue came from hydraulics, because water, unlike air, carries real strength. What's interesting, their early prototypes used air, but air was too weak and needed a bulky compressor. A hydraulic pump, on the other hand, fits neatly into the abdomen. That's why today it fully runs on water. The result? A new artificial muscle they called myofiber. This was their first real breakthrough. And it's really impressive and powerful. Imagine a muscle weighing just a gram can lift more than 300 times its own weight. The myofiber muscles are also fast, contracting in under 50 milliseconds, almost as quick as ours. And based on these new muscles, they started to build the hand.
But when we first started the company, we started by focusing on making a durable human-level robotic hand. And within the first 18 months, the company itself, this is something we managed to do and something that I'm very proud of.
And that's no coincidence. The hand is one of the most complicated parts in the human's body. It would seem impossible to replicate. It's a hand packed with dozens of muscles, ligaments, and joints. It moves with 27 degrees of freedom. No other startup has mastered the hand at this level. It's strong enough to lift up to 15 pounds. And it can actually use human tools. So they started with the hand first. 3 years later, they revealed the clone torso. And in 2025, finally, the full android with legs, Protoclone. I saw it myself, live. And it's seriously impressive. We've been prepared for this moment our whole lives. The Matrix, Terminator, Westworld, and now it has become reality.
Our vision for a musculoskeletal clone comes from a deep desire to make an android that can do anything a human can do. So a functional human clone.
Just think about it. If you want to build the most advanced, perfect robot, why not to copy the most advanced machine that exists today? Us. Our body was perfected by millions of years of evolution. It's flexible, strong, and extremely energy efficient. We are far from the most perfect mechanism, but we are the most universal one. And that's exactly what Clone is targeting. What you see here isn't just a frame, it's a complete skeleton. With over 200 bones and more than 1,000 myofiber muscles, it mimics the muscular, skeletal, circulatory, and even nervous systems of a human. The bones are 3D printed from a lightweight polymer. The beauty of this design that the muscles even attach at anatomically accurate points, giving it natural motion and range, so it moves just like you. If we go down, inside the rib cage sits the valve system, almost like synthetic organs. And at its core beats a heart. A hydraulic pump. Instead of pumping blood, it pushes fluid into the artificial muscles, filling them with pressure so they're able to contract and move just like real muscles do. What's interesting, the water isn't just for movement, it cools them down. Just like in our own bodies, where blood flow regulates heat. And here is where the story really splits. Most humanoid robots today, from 1X, Figure, Tesla, they are amazing. But they depend on motors, which comes at a cost. Motors drain batteries, add weight, and make movement stiff. Clone decided to break from this path, and instead of motors, they are using synthetic muscles, as we discussed. What's interesting, this single decision changes everything about their robot. The muscles give it more degrees of freedom. Protoclone has over 200 degrees, while its competitors between 30 to 60. Could this be the iPhone moment in the market full of BlackBerries? I'm excited to see what you think in the comment section below. And remember to subscribe to the channel. Next, we are coming to the most interesting part. We will talk about the brain and intelligence, and what this robot is really built for. Because this isn't just robotics, it's AI at work. In 2025, over half of all companies are already using AI. Research shows that 40% of people worry AI will replace them at their workplace. But in reality, it's people who use AI will replace the ones who don't. And it's already happening now. Microsoft, Google, Amazon are currently hiring people that understand AI, who know how to build with AI. And this isn't just about getting a job. If you're building a startup like me, or create anything, or a working professional, AI, in fact, isn't a threat to you. It's a leverage. Used right, it can save you hours of time and thousands of dollars in cost. And you need to learn how to use it now. This is why I highly recommend joining this 2 days AI training by OutSkill, which takes you from beginner to advanced AI professional in just 16 hours. It's valued at $895, but I partnered with OutSkill to provide 1,000 free seats for you. This 2-day program offers 16 hours of live AI training spread across 2 days, happening on this Saturday and Sunday, 10 a.m. to 7 p.m. of the coming weekend. In this training, you will learn more than 20 AI tools, prompt engineering, developing AI agents, and more. and exclusively for my audience, you can join it for free. You can click the link below or scan the QR code here. And thank you, OutScale, for sponsoring this episode. So, how does it perceive the world? It turns out just like us. It's packed with sensors all over its body. It has 4 depth cameras in the head, over 500 sensors across the body, including 70 inertial sensors to track movement, and 320 pressure sensors built into the muscles and skin. Those pressure sensors are critical for allowing it to grip objects gently, without even thinking. Without them, a robot could simply crush a cup. Just think about it. It's not just bones, muscles, and sensors. It's all linked and working together as a single system. But what a body without a brain? Especially when we love deep dives into hardware on this channel. Let's have a look what drives it. Inside the skull, an NVIDIA chip does the thinking. Think of it as a supercomputer packed into something the size of your hand.
Today it's just the NVIDIA Jetson chip that controls the entire robot. Over the longer term, it will end up using ASICs across the body, kind of like in the human body where you have neurons near the heart, you have neurons at the wrists, and I expect that in the long run we may end up adding ASICs in various parts of the body.
And on the background, they're training the foundational model that controls vision, move, and reaction in real time. The critical part here is to be able to process sensors, vision, and even multiple AI models in real time inside the robot's skull, so it can react instantly without waiting for the cloud. And that's it. What is left is to wrap it in skin, get the blood flowing, and then just send it back in time. Here is a big question. What is the point of building a human-like body and brain without a purpose? And this is where things start to get really interesting.
The clone is the ideal human companion. Your clone is your complement that fits into your life like a perfect jigsaw puzzle piece. So you wake up in the morning and your clone is at your bedside with a tray and breakfast bites and an orange juice. And you get to your workplace and your Android is acting as your assistant, helping you make your job super easy, whatever your job may be. This is sort of the Android companion lifestyle we envision at Clone, really transforming every aspect of your life, being as sort of attached to you as your iPhone is today.
For their first fleet, the robot will simply learn from you. Imagine it stands behind you, watching what you do, and then just copies that. Imagine it can cook your favorite dish just the way you like it. You can talk to it in natural language, and it can do household tasks we all hate, like dishwashing and laundry. What a dream come true. But before this beautiful vision becomes real, they first have to solve quite some technical challenges. And the first one is obvious. Walking. Right now, the robot is still hanging on cables from the ceiling. They are in the process of teaching it to balance and walk on its own.
Today, the milestone that we're aiming for to, blow everyone's minds, including ourselves, is getting to the untethered walking biped. So, like, really the first synthetic human is mobile, walking on its own. It doesn't require any kind of cable to the grid or tube to a central pressure source. That involves not only, obviously the physics simulation and software required to train it to walk, but also requires a ton of compactification and clever arrangement of valves, batteries, hydraulic power unit, which includes not only the pump, but, you know, accumulators, a reservoir, a ton of tubing and cabling, and getting all of that fit inside of the limited volume we have inside of the ribcage. So this is largely the focus of the company outside of continuing to improve the biomechanics of the robot.
This is one of the hardest challenges in robotics, because actually on Earth, not so many creatures manage to master bipedal, so 2 legs, balance, because we humans have a very complex system. Our ears helps us to sense tilt and stay upright. And this is a complex system working every second. Many animals rely on a tail to keep their balance. So this robot doesn't come with this feature. Protoclon has to learn balance entirely from scratch. The secret here is in neural networks, which drive every movement. And before the robot even touches the ground, it spent countless hours practicing in a simulation. And already the next generation, Clone Alpha, is being designed to walk like a human.
In terms of aesthetic appearance, you can imagine it's going to have skin. So it will won't have all these muscles exposed in the robots that we actually end up selling. By capabilities, we should have a first version of a robot foundation model that's capable of learning to perform new manipulation tasks.
For now, the robot doesn't have a face, but eventually it will. And the challenge here is huge. If you don't replicate them perfectly, you fall straight into the uncanny valley.
It's a challenge to make a face that's compelling, that fits the aesthetic of the rest of the robot, so it essentially needs to be a perfect human face with 40 facial muscles replicating every little micro expression in the human face. So this is something that we'll treat really well and make sure we get right before we introduce that likely separate product line to the market.
But giving a robot a body is only half of the story. The bigger question is, how do you give it a mind? The challenge is, training humanoids isn't like training a large language model. ChatGPT and other language models know more than any human, but they've never lived in the world. They never felt weight, cold, or heat. And most importantly, they don't comprehend the consequences of their actions. What I'm trying to say is that feeding data for training of humanoids is not enough. You have to invent entirely new control systems and then teach it how to interact with the real world. For that, Clone Robotics will use a physics simulator. Basically a virtual playground where thousands of androids can train in parallel. Basically, the idea is to create endless synthetic worlds where androids can fail, try again, and learn faster. They have to interpret sensory inputs, vision, touch, balance, in context. In short, humanoids learn the way we do, by doing. So, here is a question. Does true superintelligence actually require a body?
A superintelligence doesn't require a body, but it makes it probably a million times more useful to us. You're almost nerfing your superintelligence if you don't give it a body. The vast majority of the things that I want to command some intelligent system to do is in the real world, because I'm an embodied being. So to drive utility out of a superintelligence, I'd argue that you really do want it to have a body. And so robotics will end up becoming this great lever for modern deep learning, modern AI.
But why copy humans with all our flaws? Why not to build something superior, stronger? I think those kind of robots could be just too much. Too strong, too heavy, and too unsafe to live at home with us. I think that's why Protoclon isn't built like an indestructible machine. It has, just like we have, relatively fragile joints and limited motion. Probably if we share the same weaknesses, we will feel more safe standing behind them. Will it become a part of our lives? We will find out soon. This episode is definitely one of my most favorite to date. We put a lot of effort in it, so please share it with your friends and colleagues. And it's definitely worth listening to our full conversation with Danush. I will upload it on Apple Podcasts and Spotify. Make sure to check it out. It's a great deep dive into robotics. Thank you for your support. Love you guys. See you in the next one. Ciao.